Yes. Next one, Purnima. Yeah, this is the Chinese wok. Actually, we can relate this to our vanal, our very own vanal, which we use in the Tamil kitchens. It's very much part of our cooking. So this is a big similarity between the cooking styles. Next one. Yeah. So these are Chinese jars, which you can see in all traditional homes in Kerala. The big families, ancestral homes still have these Chinese jars with a lot of Chinese designs. Even my ancestral home has a lot of them. And sometimes you can see plain jars. Sometimes you have a lot of designs, especially the one in my home has a dragon design. They are very beautiful and very expensive also. And they were used for storing pickles. Throughout the year, they make pickles and then store them in these jars. And sometimes they are also used in Ayurveda for storing herbal medicines, decoctions and all that. Yes. Next one, Puni. Yes. So, this much about, this is just an introduction. Actually, I'm doing a lot more research into the topic, but I wanted to at least share something which is really visible to every tourist who visits in Kerala. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Should we take the questions now or should we take it after Bala finishes?
Either way, sir, no problem. If there are questions,
I think we'll finish it now.
Take it right now.
I think you can take it now because things are still fresh and you can go back to some other slides if required.
Yes, sir.
Let me start off with a question.
Yeah.
You know, there's a distinct difference in the temple architecture in Kerala.
Yeah.
Vis-a-vis the temple architecture elsewhere, you know, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu.
Yes, sir.
Why is this so prominent? You know, was that there was a greater influence of Chinese architecture?
Actually, when I was doing a little research on this, I came to read that this type of architecture actually came to Sri Lanka first, not India. It came to Sri Lanka, and from Sri Lanka, there were a lot of people who migrated to Kerala. They are called Ilavas. Ilam is Sri Lanka, right? So they are still called Ilavas, and they brought this structure along with them, and that is how these style of architecture came to Kerala. This is what I read, sir.
What did Kerala have before all this came in? Obviously, they had their own indigenous architecture and all that. So,
yes, sir. But
is it,
this is
very is it that they abandoned it?
Yes. This type
is it
of
that they abandoned what they had, or is it that we do not have record of what they had on their own as indigenous?
No, there was temples, but then this is more prominent now. Almost many of the temples have this style of architecture. And one more thing is, initially they were Chaitya halls, but later now they are functioning as Hindu temples.
All right, others who want to ask any questions, please go ahead.
Yeah.
I have a comment.
Yes, sir.
I think the interaction between South India and China started with Kerala much earlier.
Yes.
I think even before the Christian era, I think there was a lot of pepper being exported from Kerala.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Now, I think this interaction may also have had an influence in bringing the temple style to Kerala.
Yes.
Of course, in Tamil Nadu, it was different. It was much later. I think Tamil Nadu temples perhaps are much later than Kerala.
Because the Dravidian style was already there and was very prominent. You don't see many of this type of temples in Tamil Nadu, right? So there was, and even if you compare this with temples in Bihar or Orissa, you can see the pagoda style, but the individual tiers or stories are not clearly visible from outside. Maybe they have stories within the temple, but the Gopuram as it is similar because it's a tall structure. But the stories are not in as clearly visible as in Kerala. So that is a different style. Yes.
Any other questions?
Yes. I have a question.
Yes, sir.
During what period did this Chinese come to India, South India, or Kerala for that matter? You show all these influences.
Yes.
What is the period?
Period, I think I have to do a little bit of research on that, sir, because we have to compare. If you say South India, we have to compare, like what LVK sir said, when they came to each and every part of South India, maybe which was earlier, which came later, that I think we have to do a little bit of study. Definitely, I'll do that and let you know, sir.
And how long did they stay? Even if they came to India, how long have their influence stayed? I mean, did they just come to visit and disappear, or did they stay here?
No, no. As I mentioned earlier, there was a lot of commercial activity going on. So it was not a short-term visit or a tourism idea. No. They wanted to do business with South India. And that was the main reason. Their ships have been laden with goods. And some of our interns had also done a research on this. We still have this Chinese silk umbrellas used in temple processions. And it is still used in Kerala and Tamil Nadu also. So it was not a short-term affair, sir. It was not just a visit to Tamil Nadu, South India. There was a lot of commercial activity going on. And in the process of their commercial activity, there was a cultural exchange as well, the elements of which are still seen in Tamil Nadu. South India, as it is.
Did they have any effect on our cuisine?
Cuisine means, in the sense, there was a lot of spices exchanged, sir. Actually, more than their effect on our cuisine, it was our effect on theirs, because we gave them a lot of spices.
Okay.
Yes, they still use a lot of our spices. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, this is Ashik here. My question is based on the documentary by Joe Thomas, who is a faculty in the Chinese Study Center in the IIT Madras.
Okay.
He's done this documentary called The Dalit Children, where he tries to trace the linkage between Kerala to China. But the thing is, it's quite unique in that documentary again is that it all just boils down to Kerala alone, and it does not go beyond Kerala to other southern regions like Tamil Nadu, especially Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and India. Any idea why only Kerala was closer to or has some links with China and not the rest of the place?
Maybe what I would say is other places in South India, they had their own culture. And here, that was very strong also. They had their own architecture, they had their own cuisines and all that. But it does not mean that Kerala did not have anything of its own. But I think the main reason was the maritime connect. So the harbor, the maritime connect, so that actually facilitated a lot of exchange. Initially, it started with commercial activity. But later, it was also there with Tamil Nadu. But Tamil Nadu had a stronger Dravidian influence. So there was an exchange, but it did not get heavily influenced. But Kerala, I think, I really can't understand why Kerala was more influenced, more easily influenced. But we can see a clear influence in Kerala compared to the other parts of South India, sir.
Let me offer a simple explanation.
Yes, sir.
You know, if you go back to the exploits of Admiral Zheng He, you know, who is a Chinese admiral from the Ming Dynasty, who traveled from China through the Indian Ocean region all the way up to Africa.
Okay.
This was to spread the message of the fact that China is the Middle Kingdom.
Yeah.
And, you know, they carried a lot of goods. The size of the ships were phenomenal.
Yes.
And, you know, when you look at the geography, as you round Sri Lanka, the first coast that you hit is the very southern tip of Tamil Nadu and then Kerala thereafter.
Yes.
And also the composition of the empires even in Kerala and others were also not as defined today. There was a lot of cross-pollination that was taking place as far as empires were concerned.
Right.
But geographically speaking, and from the point of view of a great circle chart, which we use as mariners, this would have taken them in the closest path to Africa. So the stopover obviously was somewhere in Kerala, whether it is Thiruvananthapuram or Calicut or wherever. Then the fact that Kerala was home to all the spices, the spice capital of India, made it important for them to stop there and not so much in Tamil Nadu. So this is just an explanation looking at the maritime charts. in the voyages of Zheng He, you know, which we have record, which was carried out nearly 600 years ago.
Kollam was also a very active
book. Yes. Yeah. Is Sridharan there?
May I say something here?
Yeah.
Please,
I think Zheng He was much later, even earlier, several centuries earlier, pepper was being exported from Kerala. And I think the Keralites actually left the transport of pepper more to the Arabs. I think it was only in the Tamil Nadu time that Tamil Nadu merchants actually went to China. I think the Keralites, people from Kerala did not really go to China as much as people from Tamil Nadu did. They allowed the Arabs who came from the west to trade with India. They took the pepper and transported it to Kerala, to China, and sold it there. So I think the Kerala-China connection was much stronger from the earlier times, I think.
Yes. Yeah, no, this point is valid in the sense that, you know, the only reason I quoted Admiral Zheng He is because they still use the sail ships. And the sail ships, you know, have been going on for centuries even before Zheng He undertook this passage. So obviously, you know, whether it was Vasco da Gama or whether it's anybody else who was trying to find India, you know, all these people were using the sail ships, you know, before the industrialization took place. And the example of Zheng He was only quoted to trace the navigational routes that were followed by him, which he followed from his ancestral, you know, tribes who moved into India and beyond. Sridharan, can you come in? You wanted to get in, but we couldn't hear you.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Question.
Yes.
What is the effect of the influence of the Chinese on Kanchipuram saris? They are big in the silk trade, and Kanchipuram saris are also a silk-based commodity. I mean, is there any connection?
Actually, very recently, I heard a very interesting story from someone, sir. I don't know how far it is true. They say that a Chinese princess, she was walking in a garden, and her garment got entangled with something. And as she tried to release her garment from that, it went on like a long thread. And she was trying to find out how long the thread could go. And in the process, she discovered a cocoon. And that is how they discovered silk and all that. It's a very interesting story. And she wanted to try making a garment using this silk. And that is how they discovered silk. That was an interesting story, but I don't know how far it is true. But then definitely there was an exchange of silk, sir, because this white silk, they say it came from China and started being used in Tamil Nadu. It's still used in the temple umbrellas. It's called Venkotrakudai. Venkotrakudai means, Kotravan means king and Ven means white. So it was used as a royal umbrella. It was also used for temple processions and all that. So that exchange of silk was there, yes. And brocade and other precious embroidery items were all there. And Chinese ships used to frequent the Tamil port of Kaveri Pumpattinam, which was a very, very busy port at that time. And many of the Chinese ships used to bring silk brocades and embroideries and all that. There was a very rich exchange.
Okay.
But Kanchipuram, I don't think that is a different technology by itself, I think. I don't think there is any influence in that. This was by its own.
But you need silk sericulture to have silk garments. So I was wondering if we got it from the Chinese or we had our own indigenous.
I think silk existed in both places, but developed in their own individual styles. That's what I think, because I don't think there was an influence on each other, but definitely Chinese white silk was used here in the umbrellas.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Uma, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. This is Karishma from Stella Maris College, ma'am.
Yes, Karishma.
Ma'am, my question is, what were the areas in ancient China where Tamil Nadu's culture was very evident or obvious in terms of architecture or paintings or material culture? I mean, precisely, I mean material culture. And if so, do we have our cultural influence existing in China even now?
Yeah, actually, when you talk about sculptures and religious exchanges, we can definitely talk about Bodhidharma and other people who visited China. And you can still see many Indian gods and goddesses being represented in Chinese sculptures. They have a lot of sculptures of, you can say, elephants and all animals and floral patterns, which are very much part of our sculptures. So you can still see them in Chinese temples, and many of them are being discovered and discussed. Yes.
May I have a moment here, please?
Yeah.
Just to add to what Seshadri Vasan said about the visit of Zhang He. Mostly, you know, they were following the trade winds, and the trade winds took them probably to the western coast of India rather than to the eastern coast of India. That was one reason Zhang He's visit, which were about four or five of the visits that he made, were through Sri Lanka to the western coast of India. And that probably also explains why some of the influences reached Kerala also through Sri Lanka, you know. That is one point. The other point was about the jars that you made. Those jars were found in my ancestor house in Tamil Nadu also for a very long time. We also used to use these jars for pickles. You know, So there has been this kind of influence.
Yes. So these jars are very very much seen in ancestral homes. They are very much part of it. And in temples also you see. Actually, the picture I showed in the presentation, that belongs to Aranmula temple. The person who took charge very recently, he found them lying in a corner. So lying dusty and all that. So he got them cleaned up. And now he has kept them for public display. Just to show the connection between China and Kerala, and just for public display, so that people can come see and appreciate the size and the sheen and all that. They stay fresh even today. They look so beautiful.
Can I offer a comment and a question
please,
as well?
Please, sir.
Much has been spoken about silk from China.
Yes, sir.
I think there is very little that has been said about cotton from India. I find from literature that the Chinese were fascinated by cotton at one time, okay? And then in the trade, a piece of cotton was worth four pieces of silk.
Okay.
A piece of fabric in cotton was worth four pieces of cotton fabric. So apparently there was a time when cotton was much more appreciated than silk. Silk, of course, they had in plenty.
Yes.
But silk apparently was also being used by the elites in China at the time. Cotton was perhaps available, but this I don't know how to match it with the price of cotton compared to silk.
Yes.
But the point is, we should not forget about the cotton exports. But I don't know from where they, this is the question, I don't know from where the cotton was obtained for export to China. Tamil Nadu did not produce cotton so much, nor Kerala. So from where was cotton obtained to be exported to China? Apparently, every state in India has had its own ancient links with China.
Right.
Every state in India. So we have focused essentially on Tamil Nadu, Kerala, the southern part. Maybe we have look at Orissa and perhaps Bengal.
Yes.
I think there was a lot of trade also from Bengal to China. Okay.
Yes.
So maybe we should also focus on that.
Yes, sir. And Kerala also had Dutch influence. Vasco da Gama had visited. So Kerala was very very active in trade with these countries, China, Arab countries, and Dutch. Lot of activity was there, sir.
Move on to Bala.
Yes, sir.
Bala, you there?
Bala?
Yes, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for the presentation. And I take this opportunity to thank C3S and Komodo Vasan sir for giving me this opportunity. So, literally, I have to tell you this. Yesterday, the amount of trust that I have on my laptop is the same amount of trust I have on China. So yesterday I had to let it with Purnima. Thank you, Purnima, for being my alter ego today. And I'll be explaining everything, and she'll be presenting these slides. Yeah. So today my talk is going to revolve around the presentation, looking at the different aspects of India-China connections, looking at briefly on art and architecture, personalities, Buddhism, the maritime connections, trade, and also all the places that depict, that stand as a witness to the cultural connect between India and China. Next slide, please. So this is a setting that I would like to take you to. So imagine it all is happening in the ancient and middle ages, where swarms and networks of caravan, they all depart from China. And it was the Silk Route basically which wanted to witness, which tries to link the Eastern and the Western civilization along dusty long roads, carrying ideas, thoughts, along with trade in gems, spices, gold, silver, whatnot. So basically it's majestic. No, the first slide, please. The earlier one? Yeah, please stay here. I'll tell you when to change. Yeah, thank you. No, first one. Yeah, so basically the... Purnima, can you please go to the previous slide? Yeah, please stay here. So the Silk Road, it basically stretched from China to Korea and Japan in the east, and it also connected China through the Central Asia, connecting India in the south, and it went on up till Turkey and Italy in the west. So though themselves the roads were, they were very poor in condition. You can imagine how it must be in the ancient times. The roads themselves were very poor in condition. The travelers in caravans had to brave through all the bleak deserts, high mountains, extreme heat and cold, whatnot. And the historians and records state that they even had to face the bandits, raiders, imprisonment, starvation and whatnot, each and every other form of privation. This is what the condition was. But still, it also has a sea component also. So going by sea, they also braved all the uncertainties of weather, poorly constructed ships, and also even pirates in the sea. So because of the goods and ideas were in great demand, and they also commanded very high prices, including courtly rewards, including spiritual benefits. So it was worth the trouble. It was worth taking the trouble and transporting to all these great distances. So let me tell you, this is the Silk Route, the great route which ran through Central Asia, several nations, connecting several people, connecting cultures. It brought an interaction between the music, musical instruments, architecture, philosophical, religious ideas, all those, whatever it traversed through. So we are today talking about the two great civilizations. They stood as a witness to amaze all the worlds with their riches, which is the Indian and the Chinese civilization respectively. So along everywhere, whether the Silk Road and everything, it prospered. They grew up prospered along the Silk Road. Next slide. Okay. Yeah, please stay here. So we all must understand India. India is the only, it has a very unique flavor to it in the world standing, because India is the only country where they four great religions to the world. Imagine Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism and Sikhism. So here I would like to take about the concept of Buddhism, Buddha, who was also called the Sakyamuni. So it was a very powerful religion that transmitted from India to China along the Silk Road. This was Buddhism. India in those times, it was known in China as the country of land of Sakyamuni, which is the Buddha. So the Buddhism forged and it brought the two ancient civilizations basically together. It woven a very strong bond. And the legend has that the Buddhist missionary from India, they made their first appearance in China even before the AD. It was roughly around 217 BC to be very exact. They made their first appearance in China as early as 217 BC. So this is a time period that we are going to start to traverse on. So it is also widely known that all the Buddhist monasteries in large numbers, they arrived in 65 AD, where the Han Emperor Ming invited all the Buddhist teachers and scholars from India to China to spread the word of Buddha and the sermons of Sakyamuni. And as usual, the Chinese invitation was very, very lucrative. Same like the, what the Chinese now, the BRI, where the Chinese sell the idea of BRI and all nations get into a debt trap. It was even lucrative then. So it is not, I think, a new thing. It's a Chinese way of strategic thought, I would suppose. So the Chinese invitation and offer was very, very lucrative. And there's a very interesting story that I would like to narrate. So there was this Han Emperor Ming. So he, in his sleep, he once dreamt of a golden deity, which was hovering around his palace. So he was very scared, afraid, and perplexed. And the next day, he discussed his dream with all his courtiers, where one of the courtiers said the deity was none other than the Lord Sakyamuni himself, the Lord Buddha himself from India. So that is how India was known. So India was known as the land of Buddha. So subsequently, what happened? So what happened was the emperor then dispatched a mission to India to invite all the scholars and disciples of Buddha to come to China and preach his teachings. So this message, this order of the Ming's emperor bore fruit. And subsequently, what happened was two Indian monks. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah, this you can see the Han emperor inviting all the Buddhist teachers and scholars to China to spread the sermons and word of Buddha. So what hearing to all the king's dispatch, two Indian monks, Kashyapa Matanka and Dharmaratna. They are very significant people. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah. So these are the two monks, Kashyapa Matanka and Dharmaratna. So they arrive in China. So it was a very grand affair, very, very large one. It was prosperous and the king was so happy. And to commemorate this Ming Empire, he built a very great monastery on the Eastern Han Empire, which is now known as the present day Luoyang, to accommodate the holy Indian guest who will start the propagation of the Sakyamunis, the Buddha's teachings and everything. Can you please go to the next slide, please? Yeah, this is it. So the record states that the two Indian monks, the Kashyapa Matanga and Dharmaratna, they came to China arriving riding in white horses. And this monastery itself, what you see in the pictures itself, the monastery, it's called the Monastery of White Horses. Let me tell you, this is where the seeds of Buddhism were first sown in China. So this is very, very significant. So the picture to the top, you can see that is a monastery. And here you can see the replicate of the white horse signifying the arrival of Kashyapa Matanga and Dharmaratna. And this is a tomb that was it. So it is the monastery, the tomb which you see, the lal towering structure. It's called the Timasi Monastery. So you won't believe till today, all it attracts Buddhist monks and tourists today all over Asia and from the globe. So let me again go back to the historical setting. So what happens? So encouraged by the reception given to the monks at the White Horse Monastery, so all scholars around the globe, they got to hear the news. They got so happy and they began to pour in from different parts of the world, be it from Central Asia, other parts of the world, especially from ancient the kingdoms of Bayana and Kucha. They all lie along the Silk Road. I couldn't find a proper map, so I couldn't put that. So this is very significant. The ancient kingdoms of Bayana and Kucha, they also, along the Silk Road, they also poured into China. However, what happened was, beginning from the 3rd century AD, there were more inclination and willingness among the Buddhist monks and scholars of China, where they felt more inclined to come in direct contact with India and the Buddhist scholars. They want to get in direct as they want to get some direct learning from here. So as you all know, India is a land of, the land of Vedic culture, where we stand for the Atithi Devo Bhava, which signifies, the relationship, the host-guest relationship, which embodies a traditional Vedic philosophy, where we revere the guest with the same respect as we treat God. So this itself is very important. It was taken from the Taittiriya Upanishad in Sanskrit, where the Atithi Devo Bhava means the guest is God. So it is a code of conduct of Indian hospitality, which is renowned around the globe till today. Even the Indian tourism uses this slogan for this. A genuine desire to place the guest above all. I think the reading goes in the, it was from Shikshavali. It reads Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, and Guru Devo Bhava, and the last one will be Atithi Devo Bhava. So again, going back to the idea, so India responded to this development with open arms and with warm feeling and everything. Subsequently, 100 of them poured into China by both the land route as well as the maritime component. From both the end, the people started to pouring into India. And in return, can you please go to the next slide, please? In return, after you in India, they to China with huge effects which are not available in China. So now, I would like to draw your attention, the audience attention, to one point where the period of the Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir started to become a flourishing center of Buddhist learning in this period. And a number of monks from China went to Kashmir and they translated a very large amounts of Buddhist text into Chinese. And one of the first Kashmiri scholars to go to China was Sangabuti. So he reached the northern part of China in the year 381 AD. And he was received, given a very grand welcome by the, all the leading Buddhist scholars in China at that time. And they even went to the extent of requesting him to stay there and translate all the works. And up till 384 AD, where he was staying there, he has translated three works. The most significant of one is the Vinaya Pitaka. So just to give a small glimpse, the Buddhism has three Pitakas, which is called the Sutta Pitaka, Vinaya Pitaka, and Abhidhamma Pitaka. And to give a brief on the Sutta Pitaka, is nothing but a collection of Buddha's direct sermons and teaching. The Vinaya Pitaka deals with the governing rules of the Sangh, the monks, how they should be, the code of conduct and everything. And the Abhidhamma Pitaka deals with the Buddhist philosophy and doctrines, so the core doctrines of Buddhism. So he is also given a Chinese name. Sangabuti was even given in the Chinese inscription, he is stated as Seng Kya Poch. That is how he is referred to in all the Chinese scriptures. While this was going on, and while he was still working in China, there was another great Buddhist scholar, an even more outstanding genius from Kashmir who came. He was the legendary Gautama Sangadeva. And Gautama Sangadeva, he specialized in the metaphysical aspects and literature of Buddhism, which is called Abhidharma. And he reached the Kanan, the Chinese capital of former Xin Dynasty, in 383 AD. So this was also the period where Sangabuti was still working in China. And Gautama Sangadeva was to give a small picture about him. He was a very great scholar of profound knowledge. He revised all the, he took pains to revise all the earliest translations, explained the text to his Chinese counterparts, even picked up the Chinese language also. And then, interestingly, he traveled from North to South China in 391 AD. And there was a very famous Buddhist institution at that time. It was called the Lushan Institution, which was founded by a great Buddhist scholar named, he is recorded as Hui Yuan, H-U-I-Y-U-A-N, Hui Yuan. So the Gautama Sangadeva, he specialized, since he specialized in the metaphysical literature of Buddhism, he also translated a few Sanskrit texts, the most significant being the Madhyamaga Sutra. And he also translated eight works in total. And by this time, contemporary, what was happening in India was that parallelly by the 7th century, the Nalanda University was, it started to play a very prominent role in the Buddhism, spreading the tenets of Sakyamuni Buddha, propagating the teachings of Buddha in China, as Kashmir did in the earlier period. So from 3rd century, we have now come to the 7th century. So parallelly, these things were happening. And one of the noted scholars of Nalanda was Prabhakara Mitra. So Prabhakara Mitra, he basically settled in the monastery of Nalanda. And he studied all the philosophical texts with the help of a great Buddhist scholar and teacher, Srila Bhadra. And this Srila Bhadra is the one who is also the personal tutor to the Chinese Buddhist monk Huan Song. And he translated a number of works into Chinese. So he studied under Srila Bhadra. And next to coming into the second complex, can you please go to the next slide, please? Yeah, thank you. Records and historical records state that the first travelers to India to China were probably the traders, and we all know the Chinese traders from the southwestern part, Central Asia. They have been intermittently, periodically visiting India. They were responsible for introducing several things into India, and the earlier Sanskrit verses and texts refers to the Chinese silk as to be one of the most prized commodity. Let me the earliest Sanskrit verses. And interestingly, the vermilion or the sindoor, which we call, was also introduced by the Chinese, and including the, of course, the bamboo, the Chinese bamboo, as the merchants plodded towards India through the hilly tracts of Burma, Assam, across the deserts of Central Asia to Upper India. So these are some of the Chinese silk, which you can see in the picture, the vermilion, everything was introduced to India. Yeah. Can you please go to the next slide, please? So Buddhism basically took a very stronger roots in India after three legendary, the Chinese pilgrims who came to India in the, starting from the middle of 2nd century to the middle of 3rd century AD. So they stayed in a monastery specifically and specially built for them in the Bodh Gaya. So beginning of 4th century, the Chinese Buddhists, they began to take a very keener interest in India, the Indian culture and everything. The first most enterprising Buddhist scholar I would like to talk about is Fahin, which you can see that in the picture. So he began his journey in 399, around 4th century, close to 4th century AD. So he crossed, actually many records say that he came directly to India. Actually, it's a different way. They crossed the Central Asia. He reached the northwestern India in 402 AD during the reign of Chandragupta II. And he settled Pataliputra, where he intensively studied all the early Sanskrit Buddhist sutras, especially those on the monastic community and the rules order. And then subsequently, Fagin also traveled to Sri Lanka, where he spent 2 years. And then he continued his study. And finally, he set sail for China after a long and tedious voyage. So at China, he spent the rest of his life. What he did was he translated all the collected works into Chinese. And it's a very fabulous one. All the accounts of Fagin has left his travels in India as a very, very valuable record of Buddhism. So all he wanted was just one thing. He had a very single-minded pursuit. The goal was he was not interested in any other thing except the sacred literature of Buddhism and the teachings of Sakyamuni. That's it. That was the only single-minded goal that he had. And he came and he did that, actually. And another comes a legend, he's a rock star, I would say. So he played perhaps the greatest role in the history of Sino-Indian cultural relations. He is none other than the Huanzong himself, who was born in the Henan province in a family of Confucian scholars. And he later converted to Buddhism. So he was basically, initially, interested in improving all the incomplete and even misinterpreted information provided by the earlier Chinese monks, in particular Fagin. So he also, he also got very inclined to study the great academic learning centers in India. So he thought, okay, what not? Let's start a sail to India. So set out in 629 AD. It's a very interesting. There was an imperial order restraining him from not to go to India, basically. Historical records and scriptures state that there was an imperial order which restrained Huanzong from not to go to India. But despite that, he braved everything and he arrived in northeastern India in 633 AD after an arduous and tedious journey. He studied the Sanskrit and Buddhist sutras intensively, arriving in India. And not stopping short of that, he also visited all the sites associated with the Buddha, including he visited the Kashmir in north, Saurashtra, Vallabhi in west, Kamrupa, which is a modern day Assam, earlier it was called Kamrupa in east. Even he came down, traveled down south to Kanchipuram, traveling the length and breadth of India. So he's a rock star. I call him a rock star with a reason, because his prestige in India grew so great and tremendously. He entered a very royal patronage, and he made he came to the court of King Harshavardhana of Kannauj. Kannauj is the present day UP. So he made a personal contact with King Harshavardhana. So all the works of Huanzong is titled the CUK. It's called the Journey to the West, and where his association with Harshavardhana and importantly Bhaskaravarmana of Kamrupa, they add very special significance value to his work and elaborate. He also gives a very elaborate description of the Nalanda monastery, how things were taught, the pedagogical style, the quality of teachers, the way of life, whatnot, everything he has given. So again, any beginning has to have an end, right? So in 643 AD, he made his return journey and he reached China in 645 AD. You would believe the record state he took with them a mammoth one of 657 Buddhist texts and writings in 520 packages. So that is what the history states. And upon arriving at China, he was given a rousing welcome, a hero's welcome. At that time, it was the Tang Dynasty, the Emperor Gojong. And he built a very big pakoda. It's called as the Big Goose Pakoda, which is situated in the southern Xi'an region in 652 AD to welcome this hero who was back from his travels. Can you please move to the next slide, please? Yeah, so the top one which you can see, this is the Big Goose Pakoda, which is situated in the southern Xi'an. It was built in the 652 AD by the Tang Emperor Guozhong. And interestingly, after reaching China, what happened was, the king offered a government post to Huanzong, and Huanzong politely declined the emperor's offer of a government post, and he devoted himself completely 24/7 into religion, spending the rest of his years translating all the Buddhist sutras into Chinese at the Big Goose Pagoda, at the Big Goose Pakoda. And so this was not new. Even now, if you see certain things happen, people are offered a government job. So this was not something new. It was even followed in the ancient times also. So the bottom left, which you can see, this is a Huanzong temple, which is situated in India. It is in Kolkata, basically, another very beautiful one. And the top one and the bottom right is both of the Big Goose Pakoda. The bottom left picture, it shows about the Huanzong temple, which is located in Kolkata. It's even visible till today. So to give a very small glimpse of Pakoda, basically what is a Pakoda is nothing but a Pakoda is a place where they hold all the sutras and the figurines of Sakyamuni, the Gautama Buddha, that were brought to China from India by Huanzong. And the exterior and the interior walls of the pagoda feature all the engraved statues of Buddha. So this is to give a very small glimpse of the pagoda. And the last pilgrim, the last Chinese pilgrim to who was about to come to India was Xi Aixing. So he spent around 10 years in Nalanda. He studied all the subtlest of philosophies of Buddhism with greatest Buddhist teacher, who was Srila Bhadra, a very legendary Buddhist teacher Srila Bhadra was. And then he also returned to China, and he took with him a collection of 400 manuscript. And Aixing is very, very significant because he compiled the first Sanskrit to Chinese dictionary. So this is very, very significant because it served as a basis, and it made the works of other monks easier so that they could refer this dictionary. And subsequently, what happened? Now I would like to gradually take you to the 9th to 11th century, what was happening. So although the Sino-Indian relations, you know, like in the middle of, starting from the middle of 9th century, due to various interior external happenings in both India as well as China, the Sino-Indian cultural interaction, everything saw a very slightly gradual decline. But despite which, the monks did continue to come to India at intermittent intervals, and it continued up to the middle of even the 11th century. So all these are recorded and properly recorded in the Chinese inscription set up at Bodh Gaya. They have some of all these records. It states about them. And the next I would like to, what I would like to highlight is about the Buddhist connection, the Sino-Indian Buddhist connection that was responsible for the joint creation of what you call the Mahayana form of Buddhism, or the Mahayanism, or the Mahayana form of Buddhism. So unfortunately, I have to tell you this, what happened was, although Mahayana Buddhism, it originated in India, so it has to be said here that it was only because, it was also because of a tremendous contribution by the Chinese Buddhists that it played a greater force of socio-political change. Because it was, internally, China had some social structure system. So more than in India, in China, it played a very greater force of the socio-political change. And this Mahayana Buddhism is very significant because it traveled from India to China through Tibet. But the Chinese accepted it with slight modifications. You know, even the present day, what President Xi Jinping calls anything, the socialism with Chinese characteristics, or they make it everything to suit the local conditions and they call it their own. So even this Mahayana form of Buddhism was accepted in China, but with slight modifications. The difference was, it's very significant because the Indian ethos of Buddhism and the Indian ethos was basically rooted in the concept of non-violence. And the Chinese modified to suit it through violent means. The reason that they gave was they had their own reason and understanding, because they say Buddhism basically teaches egalitarianism. Egalitarianism, where everyone is to be equal. So when everybody is equal under the heaven, which is the mandate of the king, so therefore even the people have the right to overthrow the emperor, who doesn't give a good governance. So a bad king who doesn't provide the people with a good governance, he can be overthrown and restored with an emperor who is a good one. So why I say this point is that India gave to China the way to struggle, the modus operandi, the ethical format of struggle came into China through Buddhism. This is very significant. This is what I'm trying to highlight here. And the socio-political aspect that Buddhism played in the Chinese society, the internal dynamics of Chinese society. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah, thank you. So here we come. Next, I would like to talk about the Indian monk, the most prominent one being the Kumarajiva. His contributions to Buddhism, it exceeds all Indian monks because the Kumarajiva, he was the first one to head, it's called the Lijin Wang. Roughly, it can be said as the Sutra Translation Bureau of sorts, the Translation Committee of sorts, where he was heading the Translation Committee. So he basically headed a group comprising thousands of Chinese and foreign monks and scholars who were on scores of various important Chinese translation, and records even states that archaeological findings and record state that the Chinese warlord, the Yohin, he personally supervised the work of Kumarajiva. So that much of interest they showed towards Kumarajiva, his works, and to the tenets of Buddhism and the teachings of Sakyamuni. So records state that Kumarajiva, he could recite a line from the scriptures without any text before him. He would then explain the meaning. The modus operandi was, first he would start with reciting a text from the verses in his mind without a text before him. And then he would explain the meaning both in Sanskrit as well as in Chinese. So it shows that much of the proficiency and the command Kumarajiva had over the Chinese language. Subsequently, this would be followed by an open discussion where, among all other scholars, the most appropriate translation would be finally approved by Kumarajiva himself, and subsequently then it will be put into writing. So this was the modus operandi, how it was done, how the Chinese texts were translated under Kumarajiva. It's a very meticulous work. He has done a great deal. So even today, the works of Kumarajiva, they are considered to be superior than other later Chinese scholars. It is also a very unique one in translation because it survived for nearly thousands of years and created 7,000 plus chapters of translated literature into Chinese. So I think this should be one of the greatest and the most enduring joint incident translation in the world history, I could even say. So, and subsequently, Kumarajiva died in 1430, and till today, he is remembered by his tomb in Jian. So, to the right-hand side, to the next to Kumarajiva picture, you can see this is a tomb of Kumarajiva. It was constructed in 430 AD, and it is situated in Jian. So, next I would, next slide, please. Yeah. So, next I would, what do you call the rock star of martial arts, the Bodhidharma. In fact, he has taken a, he is so popular in especially in Tamil Nadu, after the movie, the Surya actor, Surya star movie, the Yaram Arivu, where it featured on Bodhidharma. So he's very, as we all know, he's a very famous martial arts teacher, the martial art tradition of Kung Fu. Actually, I think it's pronounced Kung Fu. So it was developed by Bodhidharma. So he went to China in the 6th century AD after a very arduous and tedious trek over the Himalayas. He went to the Liaowang and settled in the Shaolin Temple. So what he saw there was, he saw a very terrible condition, the terrible physical condition of the monks over there. So what happened was, what he saw was, he says, the monks basically at the Shaolin Temple, they practiced only the long-term meditations. The meditation retreat just made them strong, but only spiritually. But physically, they were very, very weak. So he wanted to change the condition. So he thought what the holistic approach to what the monks should have is that they should have a balance between the both the meditation as well as physical training. They has to be strong spiritually, which is mentally, and also physically. So he imparted physical training. So what he did was, he devised to start with just an exercise program of sorts, which involved all the physical techniques that could strengthen the body and that could also be used. It served a dual purpose. It could also be used in self-defense also. So what did Bodhidharma do was that imitated his disciples, all the natural movements of, he initiated his disciples imitating all the natural movements of birds, of animals, and those exercised into all the years and culminated into a form of unarmed combat technique, which is nothing but the Kung Fu. Then Bodhidharma instituted, he institutionalized these practices. His sole ambition was to make, one of the sole ambition was to make the monks physically strong. So it later turned out that the techniques what Bodhidharma thought, it served a dual purpose as martial training, helped the monks to defend themselves against the invading warlord, which is also shown in the movie also in the Yaram Arivu, and also against the invading threat from the warlords and bandits also. But he gave an ethical dimension component to it. He says these martial arts should be used only in self-defense, but to not and never to hurt anyone consciously. So this was an ethical component of martial arts which Bodhidharma gave a tinge to it. So to give a small brief about Bodhidharma, he was, some say he was from a Kshatriya family, some say he was even belonged to a Brahmin caste from the South Indian town of Kanchipuram. So the roots of Shaolin martial arts can be traced to, interestingly, this Shaolin martial arts, it can be traced to the Kalaripayattu, which is a martial art form from the Indian state of Kerala. So Kalari is also similar to this. It is a method of physical fitness and unarmed techniques of self-defense. To the right, you can see the picture. That is a picture of Kalaripayattu. So till today, the Shaolin Monastery is very famous. The Liaowang, it acts as a great Indian cultural. All the monuments here, it serves as a great Indian cultural ambassador to witness to the being a cultural ambassador to China. Till this day, thousands of people still enroll at the Shaolin martial arts. It has even entranced itself into the movie field also, the feature films also. Many have found stardom from years of practicing, the most significant being the Bruce Lee. Though Bruce Lee learnt the art from Ip Man, and he later devised his own technique, the basis for Ip Man techniques is nothing but the Shaolin art, which is but the Kung Fu, and even including Jackie Chan also, I would say. Next, can you please go to the next slide, please? So now let's talk about, from martial arts, let us come to the commodities. So another glaring example of the Indian influence on the Chinese culture is about the inclusion of gold as a substance of value. You know, India was a land very famous for gold, which is a very rare metal in ancient China. History even speaks of the riches of India. I remember there's a saying, the sun never sets in Britain, because the gods, even doesn't trust the Brits in the dark. So that's what the saying goes. and the peacock throne, the famous peacock throne, that one is sufficient to say about the riches what India had. So India was a land that was very famous for gold, which was a very rare metal in those times in ancient China. Because for us, gold was very valuable. For China, it was jade. I think in Tamil, they say manikam, pachai manikam, they used to say. That was the most precious item. The same way we consider gold, for them, jade was the very precious one in China. It was called yo in Sanskrit. It was called yo in Chinese. And the Sanskrit had three words for gold. I think one is swarna, and the other two, I'm not able to recollect. So Sanskrit had three words for gold. The Chinese had a word for gold, but not only for gold. They called it jin. But the Chinese word called jin, it collectively stood for not only gold, but also gold, silver, as well as copper. So then what happened was, during the times of the Tang Dynasty, the Chinese took a leaf from all the Buddhist books and attributed the best value to gold. And later, the word jin was completely monopolized to describe only gold. So that was the influence that India inculcated on China. Coming to next interesting aspect, which you see the like the small granulates, which is white color, which you see every day, which is sugar. Even a simple thing like sugar, it illustrates and portrays a very beautiful relationship between the cultural connection and relationship between the two countries of India and China. So there is one exchange in sugar, because the Chinese learned how to manufacture sugar from India, right? But the techniques of turning the bread molasses into white sugar, it migrated from China to India. So thus was born the word chini. So it indicates a Chinese origin. It was a form of jaggery. It was called shakara. Shakara, even Tamil, it's called sugar is called shakara. The colonial and French records, they call it sugar. The Russians call it sahar, I believe. The Germans call it sugar. And Arabic, with the stress, they call it sukur. So they must have come from the word chakra in Tamil, the chakra. So the Chinese transported these decolorized small granulates to India back, and it became chini. So they learned from us. Then they exported the decolorized one, and it became the chini subsequently. So this is a very one interesting tale which we can assimilate every day. So sugar is something that we see every day, that we use in our daily food. So, and then there are also Indian cultural aspect that Chinese assimilated. This is one very, very interesting aspect which is even followed till today. Whatever we give, they make it, they form it as a Chinese characteristic. China assimilated all the many facets of Indian culture in such a way that even the original identity now today, it cannot be traced or bought out. So such was their assimilation. And any Indian visitor going to China, in any monument, you can see many of Indian symbolism found in India, like the swastika. I couldn't find the relevant pictures, so I had to tell it. So swastika, the lotus, the trishul, which is the weapon of Lord Shiva, the bodhisattvas, the apsaras, they all harmonized and blended with the local milieu, and they blended with the Chinese civilization. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah. So next one. So Buddhism, if you see, it was not only a religion, it also acted as a vehicle where it transported so many thoughts and ideas. It carried scriptures from India to China. The seeds of ethics was planted through all the tales and fables. The famous Panchatantra tales influenced the Chinese so much that they transcreated and made their own version of the ethical tales and fables, including it penetrated into the subaltern literature, including the Chinese folk literature with indigenous flavor. So there you can see the portrait of epic Ramayana, the great Indian epic of Ramayana. It created a very, very deep impact on the Chinese inhabitations in the tropical Yunnan province. So even today, the Chinese tribes, they tell and retell all the stories of Ramayana. They even have the characters that entirely correspond to Lord Ram and his consort Sita. And in China, the earliest known telling of Ramayana is found in a Buddhist text. It's called Yudu Lijing. So significantly, so significant the impact of Ramayana on the Chinese was even arguably responsible for the creation of a fictional character, the same like the ape, the monkey character, what we call the same like Hanuman in Ramayana. They have the Chinese version, which was Sun Wukong, which you can see the picture below. Yeah. So that is a picture of Sun Wukong. It was like our adaptation of Lord Hanuman. So all these are depicted in a 16th century novel. It's called the Shiyo Yo Ji. So we can found all the characters that we found in Ramayana with the names of Lord Dasharatha, Rama, Lakshmana. In the 5th century Chinese text, it's called the Shishe Wang Yuan. So it depicts all these characters. And another very interesting, there's an ethnic group in China, the Dai ethnic group. They belong to the southwestern Yunnan province. And they tell the story of Ramayana as Lanka Shihe, X-I-H-E. It's nothing but the 10 heads of Lanka. So interestingly, Ramayana also traveled to Tibet, Mongolia, along with the Buddhism. But a notable variant here is that when Lord Rama goes to exile, it is not Lakshmana who, in their version, it is not Lord Lakshmana who goes, but rather it is Bharata who accompanies Lord Rama when he goes into exile. So this is to give you a picture of Indian symbols. Can you please go to the next picture? Yeah. So next one, I would like to talk about the Buddhist art. So the introduction of Buddhist art into the China is very closely associated with the arrival of what I said earlier mentioned, the Kashyapa Matanga and Dharmaratna, along with the icons of Buddha to the Han Emperor Ming, when Buddhism was slowly infiltrating into China. It was even patronized by the Kushanas from here, which was on the first period of the spread of Buddhism it started. And Gandhara, Kashmir, they all took a very leading role. And a hybrid Buddhist evolution started evolved in the northwestern India, and subsequently it was carried to China. So it distinguished itself with very, very well-defined characteristics. The first, this traditions of school, what you call the Gandhara school of art. It's very significant. I have to just give a small brief about this Gandhara school. It's a very beautiful one because they represent the first forms of Buddha in human form. That is the significance of, thanks Purnima. Please stay here. So the Gandhara school of art, they represent they were the first to represent Buddha in a very humanistic form, in a human form. So it was one of the major schools. Basically, Buddhist schools art in India, they can be classified into three major schools. One is the Gandhara, second is the Mathura school of art, and third is the Amaravati school of art. These are the three major schools of art, but the most prominent among would be the Gandhara school of art. So it was a major school in the history of ancient India. It's uniquely associated with what you call the Greco-Roman style of art. So that we can see in the pictures, I'll explain. So it was a combination of both the Greco-Roman as well as the Indian ideas, along with the foreign tradition, taken even from China, basically. So this all culminated into a pot and formed what we call the Gandhara art. And this art is very closely associated with what you call the Mahanayana of Buddhism, where the main theme was entirely, it was on Lord Buddha and all the Bodhisattvas. So it was a conjecture of an idea and a consumption of an, it was what you call, the style was Indian, but the execution was foreign. In that way, we can call it. So there in the bottom right, you can see this is the finest example of Gandhara style of art was the Bamiyan Buddha, but unfortunately, the dubious dictionary that the Taliban destroyed it in 2001. So this Gandhara school of art, basically it flourished in areas of Afghanistan, the present day northwestern India, and the prominent locations where the Gandhara school of art proliferated were Takshila, Peshawar, Begram, Bamiyan. So this art basically is said to have had a thriving, flourishing between from the 1st century to the 4th century. And it was very significant because they used extensive use of the black stones and the stucco style, S-T-U-C-C-O. The stucco is nothing but a plaster that was used for many structures, for the freestanding ones under the style of art. The stucco style was also used in the many Buddhist architectural types like Chaityas, Viharas and Stupas. So if you can see the picture, to the top right, that is the stucco art, where the protrusions can be seen in Buddha. It kind of gives a very 3D effect. So that's a beautiful stucco art. And to the bottom left, you can see the nose of Buddha. Such was the detailing. It was a very, very detailed one. You can see the facial features, very, very prominent. The nose, the upper chin, the lips and everything. And the striking pictures, what you called, it was about more of a perfection and a very natural depiction of Buddha. So it was dominated by all the themes of Buddha and the architectural motifs. And it also gave the life of Sakyamuni. It also depicts stories, themes and stories from the Buddha's former work. That was also part of the Gandhara school of art. Can you please go to the next temple? Next slide, please. Yeah. So the Chinese missionaries, once they went there, they also took with them the elements of the Indo-Greek style of art prevalent there. the Mathura, the Gupta style, that was also transported to China, signifying the, so it all, what I'm trying to say is that it evolved in a different stages. The evolution of Buddhist art, it happened in different stages with a melting pot, a different style. The execution was Indian, but the style were from, this is what I'm trying to highlight here. And also the Buddhist pilgrims, they also, along with the scriptures and texts and everything, they were equally, you know, they were very active in inspiring the artists in China. They took pictures of Buddha, statues of Buddha, images of Shakyamuni. The most interesting, even they took a replica, a small model of even the famous Nalanda University. They even took that to China. So that much of interest they had. All the vestiges of Indian art have been discovered in all over the chief cultural outpost in China, including the Bactria, Kashgar, Kusha, Tofan, Duahong. All these places where they lie along all the Silk Road. So all these places have discoveries of remains of Buddhist sculptures and paintings. And if you look at the picture, the first one, the top left, you can see this is the Duahong. The second one is the Longmen. And the third one, the painting, which you can see, it is in the Yulin. So all these three, they have a very striking similarity to the Ajanta caves in India. They have a very striking close familiarity and similarity with Ajanta. And all the themes, they represent Indian cosmology, the Indian idealism, the philosophical tradition. Even the philosophical traditions were exhibited through the art forms. So this is somewhere where the two great civilizations, they share a very common platform. And, you know, like all these caves have been hewn into the soft sedimentary. They have been chiseled very beautifully, carved out from all those soft sedimentary rock. They had magnificent murals, the stuccos, the sculptures, even the modern day, what you call the British style, the Victoria styles of silk banners and canopies were also used. And all the, this you can see the Duncan, the wall paintings, they portray a very wide range of subjects ranging from the Buddha to Bodhisattva figurine, tales from the Jatakas, Panchatantra, scenes from the, themes from Buddha's life, the Sutra illiterates, chariots, whatnot, including even the sun and the moon were given a place, and that was also carved out and exhibited in all those rocket temples. And another important thing is that the Indian influence is very, very visible in the, we can see from the Chinese inscription, because all the figurines and figures had the, you know, like the partial nudity, because the Buddha would be draped partially. One side of his shoulder will be visible. That is what I meant by to call partial nudity of figures. And the Indian type of the facial expression, what you call the countenances, the facial expression is very, very visible. So these are the most significant and prominent chief centers of Buddhist art in India. And another Buddhist architecture. Can you please go to the next slide? Next slide, please. Yeah. Next, coming to the architecture component. So even India had its tinge and touch and influence of Buddha, even in the architecture. It even spilled to the spheres of architecture also. It has a very, very typical Indian influence. In fact, it is believed, and also it is a testimony that the pagoda type of temple architecture, with all the superimposing stories that were on the, it was carried from India, especially South India, the Dravidian style. It was carried from India to not only limited to China, all the entire Far East. So such was the influence of India. All the vestiges of such construction are still found in India and far away from regions where the Chinese influence could, the Indian influence could penetrate the Chinese, and it was very apparent in the pagoda style of architecture. You can see the top one that you can see, these are all the superimpositions which are imposed on the stupa. And the below one, you can see the Dravidian type of architecture where the superimpositions imposed on the what you call the gopuram. So gopuram is the entrance to a temple, and vimana, a temple will have many vimanas, where for each deity will have a vimana. To the right, to the top, you can see the vimana of the Chinese pagoda, of all the conical, the top tall style, which was inspired from the Dravidian type of architecture. So definitely, I can say, historians also say, the records also say, yes, it does have Indian architecture had an influence and penetrated the Chinese styles of architecture. And all the mini temples in China, they had the superimposed series of roofs. The you can see the outstretched brackets on both the sides of the superimposed series. So they all belong to the first period of the Sino-Indian art and cultural interaction. All these are from body call from after close to 4th to 6th or 7th century. So this was the time period where all these were happening. Can you please go to the next slide? Next slide, please. Yeah. So now I would like to talk about the music. So as you all know, same like India, even the Chinese were very, very great musicians. Their court had, they welcomed and admired all the foreign music orchestra of various countries. They used to visit the Chinese court And literary evidence also state that the Indian music was carried to Kuchar along with Buddhism. Then there are evidence, literary evidences of families of Indian musicians having migrated to Kuchar in the earlier times. This is to give one aspect of music. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah. Next, I would like to touch upon the astronomy and the cosmology aspect. The astronomy and astrology, the cosmology also played a very important part in the ancient Chinese culture, same like India. Because we both believe that the planets just have an influence and guide the destiny of human lives. So starting from the 7th century, three astronomical schools were started in the Changmang in China. And interestingly, the names that was given was Gautama, Kashyapa and Kumara. And a very significant and interesting reference is about the Tang period, where the services of Indian astronomers were requisite on the Chinese board and ships for preparing what you call the almanacs. In Tamil, they used to call Panchangam. So the Tang period, they requested the services of Indians, where the Indian calendar system was introduced with the sun, the moon, the five planets and the north and south node, which is the traditional South Indian, the Indian astro, which is called the Rahu and Ketu. So these are also, they also made a mark and influence on the Chinese astronomy and cosmology part. Can you please go to the next slide, please? Yes. Now what I would like to bring about a very maritime domain connection with the trade with China. Basically, it continued for long, for so many years, for centuries. The Indian ports were used as a regular call points for all the Chinese ships. The prosperity of Chola Empire in India, the southern India, it was known to the Chinese very well. And the Chinese prospered by doing trade with the Chinese, with the Cholas in southern India, the southern part of India. And during the very significant, I would like to, one aspect I would highlight is about the during the early years of the Ming Dynasty, which was from the close to 1368 to 1644, where China was a very economically developed country. So they wanted to strengthen contact with the outside world. So what the Ming Emperor did was, the Zhudi, he was a Ming Emperor at that time. I think he was the third Ming Emperor. What he did was, he decided to send an envoy on a long sea voyage. So that was how the Chinese diplomat mariner Zhang Yi, he started to sail from the Chinese province of Yunnan. He led a very mammoth fleet. The records say that he started his voyage with 27,800 personnel, which had not only the navy personnel, which they had sailors, army commanders, physicians, artisans, in a very, very grand fleet of 62 ships. They set off their voyage from Nanjing. And they made the maritime port, traveling to various ports, several kingdoms, and finally they reached Kerala. So after reaching Kerala, what they did was they bartered the Chinese porcelain, silk, iron, copperware, gold, and silver. So these were the things which were bartered. And this sea route also, it marked a very important the Sino-Indian contacts with a special reference to Kerala, because we all know very well know that the Cochin in Kerala is home to the Chinese fishing. It's called the China net in Solvanga. So it's a very interesting tale. I have to tell you how this Chinese fishing nets reached Kerala. So it has a link. It's a very interesting link between the commander seafarer Shanki and Chinese fishing net. So basically at that time in Kerala, the two major seaports were Cochin and Calicut, where all the Chinese ships, they anchored, and Kerala's did their trade relations. So records state that even questions were asked in Uma Balu ma'am's presentation. Basically, the Kerala's trade relations with China, it developed and expanded till even up to the first century or 15th century. So this happened even much before the arrival of the Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama, because I think he came in 1498. He reached Kerala. So even before that, the Chinese had a touch with Kerala, and they traded with Kerala. And Kerala also received various trade items, and one of which was the fishing net. So that is how fishing net in Kerala. Can you please go to the next slide? Next slide, please. Yeah. So next, I would like to bring your attention to the dragon boat trade, for the very famous one, which is conducted in Kerala, which is conducted in China. They even have parallels in India also. Even two significant places in India where the similarities of the dragon boat race is conducted is, one is Manipur, and the another one is the famous Kerala. I think the Nehru Trophy is the one which is given for the winners in the Kerala boat race. Can you please go to the next slide? Yeah. Next, I would like to bring the attention to the theater forms. You know, till today, the Beijing Shakespeare, they depicts all the tales from the Chinese classics, where the actors and actors, you can see there, all the Chinese actors and actresses, they paint their faces with various colors. So, the thing that all the skin colors, they can be drawn to the Kathakali, they paint their faces with all colors. So, the palace can be drawn. So, coming back to the Zhengi visit to Kerala, that was very truly, to answer the question, it was a very decisive factor in this respect, because the trade relations not only existed earlier via the sea trade or on the Silk Route, but even I would like to bring your attention to the one important thing. Can you please go to the next slide? So, talking of trade, this is a large ignored aspect of trade which is called the canton system. So, basically, if you look at it, to explain the canton trade system, actually, I would like to highlight this point. Even the tinge of features of all the canton trade system of China, you can see this type of behavior with China. Even the Chinese negotiations with WTO today, the World Trade Organization, they also have a tinge of the similarities with the canton trade system. So, to come again to canton trade system, what it was the canton trade system, basically, the trade was conducted between a private foreign player and the Chinese citizens, and the chief character of all the system was the monopolistic structure, where the court will authorize commercial firms. I think at that time there were around close to 13 to 15 commercial firms, and they were known as the hawks, and they were the sole agents of foreign trade. And later what happened was, as usual, the Brits came, they monopolized the British trade to Canton. The company granted the charters to the private ships to sail from India to China under its license, under the Queen's Charter. So, but this was known as the country trade, and the ships were known as all the ships were called the country ships. And one interesting Indian connection to this is that the 6 out of every 10 country ships that sailed and made trade it originated from Bay, and 2 each from Bengal and Madras. So such was the place they made. So that was the influence of India on the canton trade system. Basically, to highlight, the canton system was served as a means for China to control the trade with the West, within its country, so that it can focus all its trade into the southern ports of Canton. Only from there all the trade can happen. So all the country traders were mostly Englishmen. They included not only Englishmen, they also included the Indians and Parsis. And taking it to the 18th century, there was a flourishing, very triangular trade between Canton, India, and England. So the exports from China to India included cloth, alum, camphor, pepper, sugar candy, which is Tamil, mittai in solluvanga, the sugar candy, while imports to China included raw cotton, ivory, sandalwood, and silver. And I think this was a time where the country trade accounted for close to 30% of the total British trade, starting from 1764 to 1800. So with this, I would like to come to the conclusion of my presentation. So what the point I'm trying to highlight here is that, a saying goes that those who forget history are bound to suffer and lose. So a very important question, because post World War II, starting from 1945 to 1950, it was a very interesting period, because four great nations, they started a journey, especially the post World War II, Germany, Japan, they started their journey, and the 47, 48, 49, India and China started the journey. But today, if you look at it, we need to ask ourselves, where do we stand? So these are the very pertinent questions, and we have to use history as the markers to ask the right set of questions, and take lessons from it, take use from it, set our course into the right trajectory. And with a positive note, I would like to conclude, India and China, two great, very ancient civilization entities with a very shared past, and have a tremendous futuristic potential. Many common issues like global warming, climate change, poverty, and others. So the two countries have a very great opportunity of playing LOCs and agreements. I'm sure we can have a positive relations in the near future. Thanks for this opportunity, and thanks to Komodo Bhavan Sir and to C3 for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Bala. I think there's one of the most fascinating presentations where Buddhism was central to the kind of relations that we enjoyed with conclusion. Well, there are a lot of similarities in what we did in the past. The present does not, unfortunately, hold promise. So unless you go back to Buddhism and China starts recognizing the importance of not just the land of Sankhya, but also a Western heaven, which also had to do with the kind of philosophical thrust that was there and the engagements. Thank you so much. I think it's one of the best presentations that we've seen in the recent past. Let me throw open the house to questions and answers. Please identify yourself and come in.
Bala, Sridhar here. Yeah, I have a few comments to make. Sir. Thanks for the excellent presentation. Really, I endorse what Commodore Vasan has said.
Thank you, sir.
A few comments. You were earlier referring to Sangabhuti and Gautama Sagadeva from Kashmir, who traveled in 4th century to, you know, China to spread Buddhism, you know. And the comment I am trying to make here is that probably they went through the present-day Ladakh, because that is where we are seeing action today. And they went through Leh probably, and you know, along the Shayok River and up through the Karakoram Pass into Xinjiang or Turkestan, as it was called before, and then into China. So there was a lot of connection Ladakh with Buddhism and spreading through Ladakh into both Tibet and China. The second comment was about Buddhism itself in China. There has been a conflict between Buddhism and Taoism and Confucianism, on the other hand, in China. And when some of the emperors decided to favor Buddhism, they also took care to make sure that they also gave equal priority to Taoism and Confucianism. So there has been this kind of tension among these three. The other one was about Huang Zhuang, and you mentioned that the Tang Emperor had put a ban on traveling to India. It was not a ban on travel to India per se, it was a ban on travel anywhere. There was the what was called the Jade Gate. The Jade Gate was the one that led them through to the Taklamakan Desert or in the Xinjiang or the Turkestan province. And there was a ban on going beyond the gate. And Huang Zhuang, went through the Jade Gate one night. But when he returned, as you rightly said, he was accorded the fantastic reception. And then his works were, all nationalized and, kept. And he was given a very good reception. And the fourth one was about Ramayana. You said that Ramayana in Yunnan province. In Yunnan province, as you also rightly mentioned, are the Dais. Dais are actually Thais. So there is no surprise that the Thai, connection with Ramayana also influenced the Dais and therefore the Yunnan province. Then the Mount Meru, you mentioned about Mount Meru. Mount Meru plays a very significant role in China. Even today in the Forbidden City, the dragon throne that the emperor had to ascend was likened to Mount Meru or Sumeru, as it was called. Sumeru plays a very important role both in Hinduism and Buddhism. The last one was about the Canton trade system that you mentioned, The Canton trade system, one of the most important shipments from Bombay was the opium. And the Parsis were the one who were, doing mostly in opium. And some of the prominent names today, Parsi names today, were all opium dealers. And they gained, a significant amount of money through opium trade. And unfortunately, of course, later it went to opium war trade, and things like that. And the history comes through. So these were the comments I wanted to make. Thank you, Bala. Thank you for the excellent presentation today.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, one point I would like to answer to Sridharan, sir. Sir, you mentioned it was not only India. The reason why I mentioned India was because even records state that, at that time, those times, the Chinese themselves, the emperor, everyone, they were very perplexed. Even I would say slightly scared. Why all everyone? Because they felt, initially, they also felt Buddhism to be a threat to their own indigenous identity and culture. So that was the reason why I mentioned, there was a ban to go to India. But I agree, sir. I concur with you, sir.
Bala, thank you for a wonderful presentation. It was very great. Okay, and you had a very wide sweep of things. Okay, now there is a question that I would like to ask, which is that many of the Indians who went to China to spread Buddhism, to be able to translate Buddhist scripts from Sanskrit into Chinese, where did they learn Chinese? It seems to me that Buddhism actually first spread from India into what was then known as Bactria, right? Central Asia, okay? And through Afghanistan, and I think Central Asia, Afghanistan, they had contacts with India, okay? And I think they must have appreciated Buddhism. They must have had also knowledge of Chinese, because the Chinese, through what they are known as Xiongnu, and ultimately they became the Huns, okay? So the Chinese were trying to fight the Xiongnu, and then they came to Bactria also to... So the Bactrians had knowledge of Chinese as well, and also Sanskrit. So I think Indian scholars learned Sanskrit, Chinese, only through the Bactrian people. That seems to me the only way these people could have learned Chinese.
Yes, I completely agree with you, sir, because I myself wanted to, if you look the Chinese history starting from the 1st century to the 6th century, so there were basically more than two, there were four connections. One was India, Central Asia, China, the land component, the maritime component, which I dealt in my first article, the Kalsal Manipravada, the Dignaga Vajrapoti, the maritime component where they traveled to China, Indonesia. And then you also had traveling through the Himalayas and northeast of India. But I want to bring all these in the bacteria, everything, but it will be like opening a can of worms. I had to restrict due to paucity of time. I was not able to explain. But I'm planning to bring out the Central Asian component of Buddhism, the cultural connect also in my subsequent articles, sir. But definitely you can look forward to it, sir. I'm trying to bring in, sir.
One other comment. I think while Silk Route was essentially through the Himalayas and the Central Asian region, after Xuanzang came to India and went back to China, he found that he was asked not to take any trip. He and his fellow Buddhist monks not to take any trip through the Central Asian route, because that was the time when Islam had already appeared. And then the Islamic preachers, along with their soldiers, okay, they had come into the Silk Route area, and therefore I think they preferred the sea route. And I think they were actually advised to take the sea route. All the trade was shifted to sea route. I think that is one area that we must also remember, that at one time, although this Silk Route and the Central Asian region flourished, I think with the advent of Islam, that actually suffered. And that is how then this trade route through seas began.
Sir, I would give a two-way interpretation, sir. The first one is, of course, Islam gave a very strong push, and it was against Buddhism in certain aspects where the Islamic invaders, they captured so many places. But parallelly, what was happening was all the Islamic traders, they also found out the monsoon, because the word mausam itself is attributed to the Islamic the traders. So the monsoon winds was found favorable, and that was, the knowledge was passed to all the people there, and subsequently they made their routes.
Sorry, I think monsoon was discovered much before Islam appeared on the scene. The Arabs did. See, before Islam came up, the Arabs were trading with India, and the Arabs actually discovered the monsoon. So Islam came much later. So you don't have to give the credit to Islam for that. There were other earlier Arabs who had discovered monsoon.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I have to dig in with this, sir. I have a slight, I'll dig in, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks for the input, sir.
Excuse me, may I make a comment?
Please, sir.
Bala, thank you very much for an excellent presentation. For a layman like me, it was like a great overview of India-China historical relations. I'll now have to go back and read more about it. I had a little comment. Mao once famously said that India conquered China without crossing the Himalayas. Whatever it could mean. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. I think this is open for interpretation, because the Chinese are they are used for giving these open sorts of interpretation. Then in that way, I would, to give a response to Mao, I would say then India dominated China culturally for spanning 2000 years. So I think that would be a befitting reply to Mao, sir.
That's probably what he meant. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Anything from the students?
If there is...
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Here, I need them to come up. LVK, sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah. Now, the question I have is, we know so much about what India's contribution to China is, and we know it mostly from Western scholars, right? Now, what do the Chinese writers say about Indian contribution to China? Not about the Buddhism part alone, okay? Of course, on that, I think the Buddhist scholars would give you a lot of credit to India. But in general, what is the Chinese appreciation of India in China?
Sir, as per going by the records, whatever I have read, I think the Chinese use it as a... Sir, let me be very blunt here, sir. The Chinese... see, basically, we both are two great civilizations, sir. So I think they use it as a strategic tool, I would say, because that's what my opinion is of them. Because appreciation is a different form, but rather they tend to celebrate theirs more rather than celebrating others also. I'm sorry, sir, I'm being blunt here, sir.
I think it's an area that we must investigate much further. Yeah, because I don't find too many writers, the present day writers, and I think the few that I have seen, they are not so very well versed in history. I think they give their own views and they are perhaps not very well founded.
Something that suits your agenda, sir, maybe.
LVK, maybe, you know, one point here that we have to... This question has to be addressed in two different eras. The modern era, the Chinese have a very different perception of India, probably. And the olden period, they had a very different perception of India as well. So today, they think that there cannot be two swords in the same sheath. So they take us as competitors, strategic competitors, and want to destroy us or subjugate us or dominate us. And in the olden period, that was probably not the case, and they accepted more of our influence and stuff like that.
Yeah, also Bala, you know, in the slide that we showed of Kashyapa, he was wearing the vibhuti.
Yes.
I don't know if was he from Kashyapa Gotra and what if that Shaivism was taken from him. So maybe this, but exploring as to what his antecedents were. With a name like Kashyapa, he must be from Kashyapa Gotra. And he was wearing this. Which means he was a follower of Shaivism.
No, I get to remember Kashyapa Gotra, sir, but I can tell it with surety, he was not a follower of Shaivism, rather he was a scholar on Buddhism, the tenets of Buddha and of the teachings of Shakyamuni, sir.
One more point, Bala, you know, the slide you showed on Zhang He and the ships that you showed there in those slides, they are very, very accurate descriptions of what we have read otherwise. Zhang He was a 7-footer and with broad shoulders and, you know, huge man. And his very presence was very intimidating to the kings and, the others. And again, he came with huge ships, 300, 400 ships of varying sizes and things like that, with so many people. And the presence of these 300, 400 ships, anchored just outside the harbor was enough to send shivers through the spines of almost all the kings, So that depiction was very accurate. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, sir. Even I also read, sir, but so initially when I read, even I also had a doubt because what do you call his presence, he was lanky, tall, more than 6 feet. What do you call the Ajala Bhagu, Arvind Lochana, they used to say for Lord Narasimha, with broad shoulders, huge body, a proportionate chisel body and everything. So then I also had a thought that maybe they are giving him too much of, to build up a character, to build up an aura around a person of some sort. Then it seems to be like he was that way. Vasant, sir, please unmute yourself, sir. We couldn't hear you, sir.
I just wanted to give some inputs on Admiral Zhang He. It is recorded that he was from the third gender, and therefore One is to say that in importance was allowed in to this.
But can't hear you, Commander.
We can't hear you properly.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there's a lot of money that was spent on shipbuilding, construction, etc. And the dynasty there was not too happy about it. Apparently, the ships that returned did not set sail again. They all were destroyed, with many being diverted to other issues. This is the reason why they lost out on being a maritime power and had to wait till this century to regain their maritime glory.
Yeah, I agree with you, Commander. You know, what happened really was the Ming dynasty. Yongle Emperor, as he was called, who was the emperor at the time of Zhuanghe, actually had, even before that, the Ming emperors had banned all the foreign trade. And it was the Yongle Emperor who actually opened the trade. And after Zhuanghe, they again closed the trade because they didn't want internal issues, etc., to be, to damage China. So after that, all these ships were at Nanjing port and where they, were destroyed. And today, I think you can see in Nanjing a replica of the, Zhenghe's ships,
LVK, sir, please unmute yourself, sir. LVK, sir, please unmute yourself, sir. We cannot hear you, sir.
One story I had heard is that the trade completely wiped out the Chinese coffers, that they had to put a stop to trade. Okay, that is one. Second thing is that at that time they had no money, so they used to pay people salaries in terms of pepper, quantities of pepper. Okay, so it was essentially salary through, not money, through some metal. Okay, and that's the reasons why they couldn't continue to have those.
One of the reasons was they used copper for, minting coins. And they ran out of copper and all the copper went out of the kingdom and things like that. So those were those kinds of issues also,
Balu?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you have something to say? Anything to
add? Yeah, Bala, I have just a few points. The word chini for sugar, which you talked about, right? Interestingly, in Kerala, the word shakara means jaggery, not sugar. They use the word shakara for jaggery. And another one is about the green stone, the comparison with jade. That was not Manikam. Manikam is ruby. Maragadam is
okay.
Green.
Okay, stone. Okay.
Yeah?
My apologies.
No problem. And the Panchatantra tales which you had mentioned. So there is also a set of tales called the Jataka tales, which relates to Buddhism very much. Right?
Yeah, I've mentioned that, ma'am. Jatakas, I mentioned that in the presentation.
Jataka, yes. Yeah. And Ramayana is very popular in Thailand, and the way it is presented is the shadow puppetry, which is called Wayang Tulit. It's very popular, and the representation of Hanuman is in Thai Ramayana. It's very similar to the picture you showed in the presentation, right? Yeah, with a crown and all that. It's very similar to that.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for the inputs, ma'am.
Well, then I think if there are no more questions, I will ask Mr. Srinivasan to sum up and wind up the show.
Yes.
Thank you, Commodore. That was an excellent presentation by Uma Balu and Bala. I really enjoyed. We all really enjoyed the comparisons between what is available in India today and what happened and how things influenced each other, and especially the words that we use, common day-to-day words that we use, and even the jars that we use in our homes and things like that, how they came are probably being influenced by Chinese porcelain technology or whatever. And Bala's presentation on Buddhism and the various cultural aspects and things like that were really wonderful. And we have gained a great deal of knowledge. And especially also after the two presentations, the discussions, the questions and answers that we had. And it's a wonderful presentation today. Thank you everyone for being part of this. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think it was a presentation that we have seen in the hearing. There's more of this in the next one. And in July, please look out for the next. Again, there will be four separate webinars on all the four verticals that we already decided. And I'm very happy to see that, we started off with something like 40 people. That's been the average strength on all these webinars, which is very good. And that's how we plan it, well in time. I'm sure we'll be able to serve more audience. And so, whatever we are planning in July, it should come out by end of this month. So that people know what the dates are, able to adjust it and participate in bigger numbers. But I think the other point is that all things are also being put up together by Fatima and Bala on the YouTube. So those of you who missed out can also access these complete webinars on YouTube. So that's also a good initiative that we can. Overall, join me in applauding their efforts. Wonderful. Keep up the good job. Have a nice day. Thanks. All the best.